morning, everyone. I hope that you're excited to be here, because we sure are glad that you're here. I'm going to ask you to stand as you are able as we begin our service this morning by singing a song called the Revelation Song.
Mystery.
together this morning to worship you, to praise you, to thank you, to love you. We invite you to be present with us this morning and pray that all that we do and say brings you glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. Some announcements. Just want to remind everybody of that Drinks of That will be here this evening. And we're going to have a Passover meal. It's at 5 o'clock. And he will inform us and teach us about how the Messiah is shown in the Passover. Jeff's going to come and give us his announcement. But also, sign the red books, pass them down, and if you have a prayer request or a visitor, put that in the offering plate with your request on it.
Just want to remind you all that in 2 weeks from today will be our first quarterly business meeting of the new year, and encourage you all to come and be a part of that. We'll be following our covered dish dinner at noon on that day, 2 weeks from today. A couple of items that I want you just to be aware of that we will have on the agenda for sure, and that is one, and I guess I'm making a little bit of an assumption here, but we'll have some more information on the trustees' issues of dealing with the siding on the church, and maybe we'll have some more information at that time, and so we'll have that for discussion item. And also I'm going to put on the agenda time to discuss, as you are, most of you are well aware of, that we've had some issues or concerns with the direction of the American Baptist Churches USA. And so we're just going to provide some time to discuss that. We've had a couple of informational meetings and a couple of prayer meetings. I know many of you have been in prayer and in conversation about this over the last few months. And we just want to continue that process in discussing that. We'll make no definitive decisions in 2 weeks, but we will have a time to discuss things. So bring your questions, bring your concerns, bring your thoughts and your ideas. And I think at the very least we'll decide whether or not we want to continue proceeding, and if we do proceed, what that will look like. And so, a couple of items coming up 2 weeks from today. Thank you.
As we go into worship today, I'm going to read the 139th Psalm. Now, it's 24 verses, so it'll take a moment. But it's a psalm about God's knowledge, His omniscience, His presence everywhere, His omnipresence, His holiness, and His creativity, how He creates. So listen as I read these words that David penned that came from the Lord. O Lord, you have searched me and know me. You know where I sit down and when I arise up. You understand my thought from afar. You scrutinize my path and my lying down and are intimately acquainted with my ways. Even before there is a word on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all. You have enclosed me behind and before and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot attain to it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even there your hand will lead me. And your right hand will lay hold of me. If I lay, say, surely the darkness will overwhelm me, and the light around me will be night. Even the darkness is not dark to you, and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light are alike to you. For you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. You will give thanks. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would outnumber the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. Depart from me, therefore, men of bloodshed, for they speak against you wickedly, and your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with the utmost hatred. They have become my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts, and see if there be any hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do pray that you search me, and that you search each and every one of us. If there be any anxious thought or any wicked or hurtful way in us, show us, Lord, that we might repent and change. Though you know us, Lord, you know us completely, and yet you still love us. And you loved each and every one of us so much that you sent your Son to die for us while we were yet sinners. And we pray, Lord, that we are a people that will be thankful and forever in awe of you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, let's stand up and greet our neighbor.
Looky up there. See in the screen?
Oh, look, that's you. See?
That's you on the TV. Oh, it's your show. Looky there.
That's you.
There's you and Mommy.
That's like...
The ushers would come forward. Heavenly Father, it is with a thankful heart that we come and give what you have given to us, that we give back, and that we pray, Lord, that what we give in with joy, and that it is magnified and enlarged by you. We pray it goes out into the world to tell the world of you. Amen.
That passage that Dick just shared with us pretty much leads into the song we're going to give you for the offertory today, because it talks about God's omniscience, the fact that he knows everything, and he knew everything before time began. And so when he created Adam and Eve, you know, he knew that they were going to fail. He knew that we were going to fail, and yet he still went ahead with his plan because he adjusted that plan and made it to where it would work for us by sending his Son. And he put all the ingredients together.
He molded and built a small lonely hill that he knew would become Calvary. Then he made the seed that would grow to be thorns that would make his Son bleed. Then he made a green stem, gave it leaves, and then gave it sunshine. his eyes. God looked down to a time, saw him spat upon, rejected and mocked. Still he grew the tree that he knew would be used to build an old rugged cross. Nothing took his life.
Something interesting I'd like to share with you. As the invitation hymn, we'll sing hymn number 305. It's got kind of an interesting background. In 1865, the nation was dealing with the end of the Civil War, and this lady who composed the text, Elvina Hall, was sitting in the choir loft, supposed to be listening to the sermon. But she was a little restless, and so she wrote a poem on the flyleaf of her hymnal because she didn't have any paper. Well, after the service, she was feeling a little guilty, so she went up to the pastor to apologize for not paying attention. And she said, but this is what I did. I wrote this poem. And the pastor says, well, that's really interesting. And he opened up his Bible and he said, he pulled out this piece of music. It was just notes on a paper that was written by their church organist. He was their part-time church organist. He was a coal merchant by trade. And he pulled out this music and he said, John Grape was his name. And the pastor says, well, let's see how they match up. So he said, I'll go through the music and you go through the words. And lo and behold, every single word, every single note, every single phrase matched up perfectly. The pastor says, well, there's only one thing. We don't have a refrain. So Elvina, she says, well, look on the back cover. So on the back cover, they opened up and there was the refrain. Again, every word, everything matched up perfectly. And so we know that while these two wrote this song, we know that it was given to us by our God. And so when we sing this song, we're singing a gift that God has given us. So with that, if you'd stand as you're able, we'll sing our hymn of worship, which you'll find on page 309. I will sing My Redeemer. We'll sing all four verses.
Of the
God, as we unite together this morning, again, we give you praise. We thank you for the opportunity. We thank you for the freedom, Lord. And as we lift these requests to you this morning, we do pray, Lord, that you would work in each of the situations. Father God, we thank you for the praise that Barbara Anderson shared earlier regarding the relative of hers that had received a kidney transplant. Lord God, we ask that you would be with her, encourage and strengthen her, and we just ask that you would give strength and encouragement and comfort and peace. And Lord, we celebrate the ways that you work in our lives. This morning also, concerning the kidney, we lift to you Jake Oppenheimer, who this weekend has been dealing with kidney stones. Father God, we pray that you would help that to pass quickly, that he would recover quickly. We pray for Jamie and the family, that you would watch over and encourage them all. We also lift to you my grandfather-in-law, Howard Stepp, as he is facing several health issues, one of them being his kidneys shutting down. And Lord, we just lift him to you and pray that you would guide and direct and bless and work and bring strength to him. Lord, we also are mindful of our team that is in Nicaragua this morning. We pray that as they unite with the residents there for worship this day, that you would be glorified and honored, that it would be a blessing not only for them, but that you would bless others through them as well. And Lord, we just thank you, and we ask that as they travel back tomorrow, that you would give them safety as they travel. We pray too for the many that are traveling with spring break, that as they make their way home, that you would give them safety as well. And Lord, this morning, we lift to you the family, a Marine family, and prayer for a daughter in the family as her husband retires from the Marines and they move back to Wyoming. Father God, we lift them to you and pray that your presence would be with them, that you give them safety as they travel. Lord, we know that there are other requests and concerns and other praises that we haven't shared this morning that we've kept to ourselves. But Lord, this time we just raise them to you in our hearts and thank you, God, again for working. We know that you are able to do it and that you do it. And we just give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated now as the choir sings Sinners Saved by Grace. As the choir comes down to join you, the children may be dismissed for children's church. Yeah. Sharon Yarrow said that. Well, I would say great minds think alike, but. Oh. What's that? Yes, maybe. Yes, Sharon and I often have the same thoughts. Not at the same time, not even in the same week sometimes, but they're the same thoughts. No. Well, I'm sure glad that you're here, and I hope that you are. I appreciate Susan playing for us this morning, and appreciate all of our pianists and accompaniment. We appreciate the nice song by Joyce and John Call. Thank you very much. Of course, we're thankful to have Dylan in the back and Jeannie in the back, filming and making sure the screen is right, and Jeff Yarrow. You wouldn't be able to listen to me without him, so. And I want to thank Jerry Mayo for his leadership of the choir, his faithful leadership. So it's always nice to have so many people involved in the worship service. And of course, we thank our ushers, too. There's just oodles and oodles of people. And I don't know who's in the nursery today, so I would thank them, but I don't know who they are. So I'm sure I know them, but. All right, during this month, it's Kimberly. Oh. God put it on my heart for a reason, so. You ever have a message straight from God, Kimberly? Oh, well. Isn't it nice to be able to come together and laugh with one another? I know sometimes you laugh at one another, but that's another story. But during this Lent time, we are going through, we're exploring several different scenes that are leading us up to the crucifixion and ultimately the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We've seen over the last several weeks, we looked at the 30 pieces of silver and explored Judas. And we were reminded of the bargain that he made and struck with the Pharisees of the betrayal that he committed against Jesus as a result, and then ultimately his bereavement. Then we saw the towel and the basin, and we were reminded of the actions of Jesus Christ. His actions of washing the feet of the disciples, yes, it pictures the spiritual washing that he does for us. His actions were also in response to the heart, the questions on the mind of the disciples. You'll remember, they were going, well, which one of us is most important? You know? And so Jesus decided to teach them a very valuable lesson, that that's not really what the priority ought to be. And so he set the example of humility. Remember that the creator of the universe, our Savior, demonstrated that even he wasn't above washing somebody's feet. And so it's an example of humility, but service as well. And then last week we considered the cup as we saw Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, reminding us that Jesus was distressed. And we talked about how it was not so much the physical consequences of what was coming, but the spiritual separation that he would experience. We saw that Jesus was disappointed, and how many of us know that there's been times in our lives when Jesus has been disappointed with us? The disciples didn't act with faithfulness. They were disobedient. He said, stay there, sit there and watch. And they didn't. For an hour, they couldn't do it. And then ultimately, we praise the Lord that Jesus was devoted. Unlike the unfaithful disciples, Jesus was obedient. Jesus was faithful, and we celebrate that. This morning, we look at Mark chapter 15. And in a moment, we're going to read it. But we look at this passage, and in this passage, we're introduced to Pontius Pilate. And I know those of you who've been Christians for a while, you know who Pontius Pilate is. He was a Roman governor over Judea, and he served about AD 26 to 36, and even Delmer's not old enough to remember that. but he served under Emperor Tiberius. He's mentioned by Christian historians like Josephus. Something interesting, in 1961, they uncovered what they called the Pilate Stone. And on it, it was dated back to about AD 30, and there was a description of Pilate and the mention of him as the prefect of Judea. So it's just one of those archaeological finds that, believe it or not, well, we believe it, obviously, confirm what Scripture teaches. His story is really one of tragedy and of compromise. And, you know, we sit here sometimes and we think about, oh, well, if I was Pilate, what I would have done. And so we're going to think about it and look at what Pilate does. But we find this passage again in the Gospel of Mark, Mark chapter 15. So if you're able, would you please stand as we read the Word of God this morning. Mark chapter 15, I'll start at verse 1 and we're going to read through verse 15. Immediately in the morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council, and they bound Jesus, led him away, and delivered him to Pilate. Then Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered and said to him, "It is as you say." And the chief priests accused him of many things, but he answered nothing. Then Pilate asked him again, saying, "Do you answer nothing? See how many things they testify against you." But Jesus still answered nothing, so that Pilate marveled. Now, at the feast he was accustomed to releasing one prisoner to them, whomever they requested. And there was one named Barabbas, who was chained with his fellow rebels. They had committed murder in the rebellion. Then the multitude, crying aloud, began to ask him to do as he had always done for them. But Pilate answered them, saying, "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" For he knew that the chief priests had handed him over because of envy. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd so that he should rather release Barabbas to them. Pilate answered and said to them again, "What then do you want me to do with him whom you call the king of the Jews?" So they cried out again, "Crucify him." Then Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they cried out all the more, "Crucify him." So Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and he delivered Jesus after he had scourged him to be crucified. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word, the truth that it is, the power that it has. And we pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts this morning. We ask that again that you would be glorified in all that we do this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Well, as we look at this passage of Scripture, as we look at Pilate this morning, we see an interaction with several groups. And we're going to talk about his efforts and their results. Particularly, we're going to look at verse 15. And there we see three groups. We see a contented crowd. If you like to take notes, you're going to get all your C's right now. We see a contented crowd, a commuted criminal, and a condemned Christ. All right? You know, we Baptist pastors have to alliterate our sermons as much as possible. So there you go. All right, so we're going to begin with this contented crowd. You know, Pilate, as a prefect or governor, was a politician, all right? And as we have seen in our country, politics isn't always an easy job. As we've seen in our state, politics ain't always an easy job. As we've seen in our congregation, we don't even want politics here, but sometimes there is. And it's not always an easy job. Politics under the best circumstances, it's not easy. So trying to find a consensus takes work. It takes effort. It takes patience. And sometimes we don't have the energy to put the work in, and sometimes we don't have the time to be patient. Pilate has this situation kind of is brought to him, it kind of falls into his lap. And I don't know about you, have any of you ever had a situation that you were faced with that you thought, man, I wish this wasn't me. Man, I wish this had happened to somebody else. I remember when Danielle and I met in a department store. You know, we worked together in a department store, and there were times when you would see a customer come around the corner, and, oh, I'm going to go work at this so I don't have to deal with them. And then later on, I worked in a bank, and I trained tellers, you know, how to be bank tellers. And there were times, you know, unfortunately, as a bank teller, most of the time you're kind of stuck there, aren't you? You can't, like in a department store, go hide behind the towels. So the customer, you know, as the trainer of the tellers, though, oh, it's always, you take care of them, you know. Sometimes we have situations that fall into our laps. You know, and this situation was kind of a situation that was greeted there with very little common ground. Very little common ground. You know, in Clay Center and the schools, they teach the kids to think win-win. You know, to try to find out a solution where, you know, both parties in a situation get something, where both places, both people win. But here, there can be no win-win. Here, on the one hand, we have the Pharisees, the religious leaders of Jerusalem, making all kinds of claims against the man Jesus Christ. On the other hand, we have Jesus, who really will not respond. He doesn't answer. He doesn't defend himself. And you know, that's a lesson that I can learn from Jesus, because that's not my personality. That's not in my makeup. If somebody says something, now if they say something that's true, I kind of smart and go, well, I come up with a reason to excuse it. But if somebody accuses me falsely, I'm going to be, hold on, no, no, that's not right, no, no, shut them down, don't let them talk until they know that they've accused me falsely. You know. Now, thankfully, and don't any of you think that this is a challenge for you to come up with ways to accuse me falsely, please. I don't need that. But we sit there, or we see this, and we recognize that it's difficult sometimes. And now we put ourselves in Pilate's shoes and sit here going, okay, we have on the one hand the Pharisees, the chief priests, and on the other hand you have Jesus. And as I think about Pilate, it reminds me that, you know, sometimes we think, well, I'd love to be the one to judge everything, and I'd love to be, you know, the one that decides everything. But when you put yourself in this situation, you go, sometimes, no, I don't want to be the one. But guess what? The buck stopped there. Pilate had to decide. Pilate had to make a choice. And to make matters worse, it wasn't an isolated meeting. It wasn't something that they were in a vacuum where nobody knew what was going on. No, there was a crowd. Now, in Scripture, crowds aren't unusual things. We see crowds all the time. Crowds were following Jesus. Crowds were amazed by Jesus. Crowds were taught by Jesus. Crowds were fed by Jesus. Crowds celebrated Jesus. But here, we find now that the crowds have been stirred up. You ever get stirred up, Diana? But are they stirred up by Christ? Well, in Luke chapter 23, verse 4 and 5, we see the claim. It says, so Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowd, I find no fault in this man. But they were more fierce, saying, he stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee to this place. So they're saying, he's stirring them up. He's stirring up the crowd. But what did Mark 15 say? It says, we see there that it was whom? It was the chief priests that were stirring them up. Now, to stir up, well, we know what it means, you know. It means to get people excited. Do you like to get excited? You know? Sure, we all like to be excited. We all like to, you know, to be enthusiastic. But it means to shake them up. It also has the idea kind of to incite them. Now, we like to be excited, but I said, if I asked you, Bryce, do you like to be incited? Well, we would stop and think for just a moment about that. Because that is the idea of getting excited with a purpose, with a goal towards something. And the chief priests had a purpose. They were inciting the crowd with what purpose in mind? To kill Jesus Christ. And in our passage, what was their motive? Envy. So we think back to Pilate. You've got this crowd that's being whipped up into a frenzy. A possible riot is about to break out, and you're the governor. You're the prefect. So what do you do? What would any of us do? Resign from the position? When the going gets tough? Well, we would do what anybody would do. We'd try to calm things down. We try to calm things down. And that is his goal here. He wants to calm things down. He wants to get rid of the craziness and kind of restore peace. And that's his goal. He desires, in verse 15 we see, he desires to gratify the crowd. And to gratify means to satisfy. It has an idea of what doing what is sufficient or adequate. It's almost like the idea of doing enough, you know. He wants to do enough to calm them down. And Pilate's goal here to do enough, his goal is to do enough so they don't rampage, so they don't rebel. And so he has an effort to create a contented crowd, and it leads him to compromise his conscience. And that brings us to the second person in our outline this morning. We have the contented crowd, then we have the commuted criminal. And it is interesting what Pilate tries to do. Very interesting, very calculated, very political. Here he finds himself in a situation where, again, on the one hand, there's one group that doesn't like Jesus. They want him dealt with. And he has a large group that's been manipulated. And he's reminded of a tradition of these people. In verse 6 it says, "Now at the feast he was accustomed to releasing one prisoner to them, whomever they requested." To Pilate it must have seemed like the perfect scenario. It must have been the perfect out. Oh, this will work out just perfectly. You know, don't you love when those situations happen, when things, oh, this will be just perfect. Oh, great, 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 great. And you can just almost imagine in Pilate's, in internally in his heart, he must have thought, oh, whew, I got an out. This will make things so much better. We can use this little custom that we got. We'll take care of it. Oh, they'll be happy. Everyone will be happy. I won't look bad. But things don't work out as Pilate planned. The chief priests and the Pharisees, they want Jesus convicted. And the truth is, there's really no evidence of wrongdoing. So again, Pilate, you know, thinking, well, maybe I can make it a good deal, you know. So Pilate gives them two choices. He's got, on the one hand, Jesus, the innocent. Jesus, the perfect, the sinless, the peaceful. And on the other hand, Barabbas, who was guilty, who was associating with rebels and was a murderer. Now, you know, you sit there going, okay, well, if I'm going to release one of these two guys back into the community with you, which would you want, a teacher or a murderer? You know? Logically, most logical people would say, well, I'd much rather have the teacher because I can ignore the teacher, you know. Not pay any attention to him. So he gives them this choice between Jesus and Barabbas. Now what is really interesting as we look at this passage of Scripture and we look at Jesus and we look at Barabbas, when you look at Barabbas and who Barabbas was and what Barabbas' name is, some ancient manuscripts and traditions have made this story even more interesting because they identify Barabbas' first name. Are you ready for this? They believe Barabbas' first name was Jesus. Oh, you say, ooh, that gives me goosebumps. Well, so that makes it, okay, here we have Jesus or Jesus. But Jesus Barabbas, you know what Barabbas means? Barabbas is kind of a combination of two words. The first one is a Chaldean or Aramaic word. The second one is a Greek one. Barabbas, bar means son, and abbas is associated with Abba, which means father. So Barabbas means son of a father. So here we have this presentation of, yeah, Randy's going, oh, really? I'm not making it up. I don't make up the definition of these words, you know. You got Barabbas, Barabbas meaning son of the father, son of a father, a father's son. And then you got Jesus here. So Pilate is giving the people the choice. Jesus, a father's son, who's a murderer, or Jesus, the father's son, who is the innocent. And when Pilate, again, he assumed that the crowd, they're going to pick, you know, the Christ. I can't say Jesus anymore, because then you'll be, oh, which Jesus? They're going to pick Christ. They would select the innocent. But, as sometimes happens, especially in politics, especially with crowds, they do unexpected things, and they chose Barabbas. The guilty, rebellious murderer who should have been punished. But instead, according to Mark 15:15, he was released. Now again, to be released, it means he was let go. It implies the annulment of an existing bond. And for Barabbas, he was in bondage literally, in chains. But now his sentence has been commuted, so he would be set free. At the expense of Jesus, the true Son of the Father. While Pilate sought to create a contented crowd with a commuted criminal, we see that he really didn't do that. Because they cried out, and they cried out. And he said, well, what do you want me to do with this Jesus? And what do they say? No, what do they say? They didn't say crucify him. They said, crucify him! You got to use your dad voice, you know. That's the exclamation point. It wasn't a little period. It wasn't a suggestion. They screamed and they cried, you know. Something we, you know, when we read through it, we just kind of go through it real fast. Because to stop, and if we were just to stop and think about it, and all of us yelling at the top of our lungs, crucify him, to just imagine what that would sound like. That's exactly what they were doing. This crowd that Pilate thought, oh, he was going to get him contented, he was going to bring peace. No. They were stirred up. And though he wanted to have a contented crowd through a commuted criminal, he ended up condemning Christ. Verse 15, so Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and he delivered Jesus after he had scourged him to be crucified. He delivered Jesus to be crucified. Now this word delivered, we've seen it before, even in the study that we're doing right now in these different passages that we have looked at. We saw it when we looked at Judas Iscariot. Remember that guy, Judas Iscariot, and 30 pieces of silver? In that context, the word delivered is translated differently. It's translated betrayed. When we talk about how Judas betrayed Jesus, it's the same word. It's the same Greek word. Here, it is delivered Jesus. In a sense, it means to hand him over. And yes, that's what Judas did. Judas handed over Jesus Christ. Christ, we see also in Ephesians 5:25, gave himself. It's the same word. He handed himself over. And here we see the political leader of the community doing the same. Now we have to stop and just reflect on Pilate's choice. Pilate saw no fault, no guilt. Pilate sought to set Christ free through, even if it was, you know, a technical loophole. But Pilate, the leader, made the choice not to lead. Instead, he was led by the Pharisees and the possible threat from the crowd. He didn't do what was right, he did what was easy. And you say, well, it doesn't seem very easy to me. Well, and we see that Pilate compromised his conscience, and that condemned Christ. This morning, we've seen this contented crowd, a commuted criminal, and a condemned Christ through the eyes of Pontius Pilate. But as we conclude, I want us to look at those same groups, but through the eyes of Jesus Christ, as he is led off, as he is heading off to be whipped. That's what scourged meant. You know? And to say he was whipped is pretty, putting it pretty easy. You know, the whips with the bones and the stones. And they would lash him and lash him and lash him. But as he headed off and turned back to think about it, instead of a contented crowd, he saw a confused crowd. They were being manipulated by people with an agenda. Instead of listening to God and being obedient to him. In 2017, folks, there's a lot of confused people. You know, we seek to be contented, and a lot of times we end up with confusion. So we must depend upon the Word of God. We must turn to the Word of God. We must learn the Word of God. We must live the Word of God. Amen. We must be obedient to Him. Instead of a commuted criminal, he saw a callous criminal. Barabbas deserved to be punished. He was guilty. I deserve to be punished. I'm guilty. Like that song says, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. But Barabbas there, he was set free and he was willing to let Christ stand in his place without recognizing what Christ had done for him. And unfortunately, many times, you know, we think, oh, yep, Jesus saved me. Yes, Jesus loves me. And we don't stop and really reflect and really think about what Jesus did do for us. And I know it's hard for us to really emotionally go through all that Jesus endured for us. But if we don't keep that in our hearts and in our minds, we do become calloused. We begin to take it for granted. And then once you start to take it for granted, you start going, well, you know, I'm really not that bad. Jesus, when he looked at Barabbas, he saw a callous criminal. And when he looked at Pilate, he saw a compromised commander. Pilate knew the truth. He saw Jesus and found no fault. He was innocent. But he gave into pressure and he made a decision that he knew was wrong. Now, I wish I could stand here and tell you that I've never done that. I've never made a decision that I thought in my heart, well, maybe this isn't quite the right decision. Maybe I should do this. Maybe I should do that. I wish I could say that I've never done that. But I've also learned that sometimes we have to take a stand. As we consider this passage this morning, as we think about the contented crowd and the commuted criminal and the condemned Christ, let us purpose in our hearts not to become confused. Let us know the truth. Whatever the world may say, let us know the truth. And what does that require? We have to put in the work, don't we? Just because the pastor says it doesn't make it true, does it? You know, I used to work with my kids, because I say so, you know. Well, Daddy, why do I have, because I say so, you know. And that may work when I say, go clean your room. But when we talk about things of the Bible, I have to agree with Scripture. Let us not be callous. Let us appreciate the truth. And let us not be compromised. Let us stand for and stand in the truth. because that's what Christ deserves. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this chance to come together this morning. We thank you for each one that is here. And we thank you for this passage of Scripture, which shows us so much emotion, so much drama, as we are being led to the point of the crucifixion. And Father, we pray that we would not be people that are confused, that we would not be people that are callous, that we would not be people that are compromised. Father, we pray too that each one of us that is here this morning can say that they have met Jesus Christ personally as their Lord and Savior, that they have a relationship with Him. We pray that if there are any here this morning that do not know Jesus, that today would be the day that they make that choice. For Scripture tells us that we need Jesus. Scripture tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, that there is none righteous, no, not one, and the wages of sin is death. God is holy, God is perfect, and we are not. And because we are not, we are separated, and there's nothing we can do. But God in His infinite wisdom, God in His infinite grace and love, He made a way, He made a plan, and He sent His Son Jesus, the Son of the Father. And He laid His life down willingly to pay the price for us. The gift of God, eternal life. And the Bible tells us that for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. We are not perfect. God is. Because we're not perfect, we need a way to have a relationship with God. God gave us that way through Jesus Christ. And we must accept that gift. Father, we pray that each one of us here this morning has made that choice for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we have our hymn of invitation, Jesus Paid It All. Again, we thank you for the opportunity to unite together to celebrate what you have accomplished for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.